Welcome to Strategy Class. This is Professor Creek, and in this video, we're going to be taking a look at EPS-EBIT Analysis, which is a technique that firms use to decide, based on this amount of money that we need, is it better to go to the bank and take out debt, or is it better to go to shareholders and issue additional shares of stock? So firms need to acquire capital. There's a couple of ways they could do that, right? Debt and stock, and really there could be a third one here. If there's enough cash on hand, we could pay for implementing strategy that way as well. But the EPS-EBIT is a way to determine, is it better to finance via debt, via stock, or some combination of both of those. And recall that for firms, too little debt can also be a problem. Right, it means that there's opportunity cost out there. We could have implemented some additional strategies, but we didn't, just to avoid taking on a little bit of debt. For firms, debt is not necessarily a bad thing. So keep that in mind as you're looking over financials and trying to determine, is debt something that the firm should be considering or not? So here's an example, EPS-EBIT analysis. And there's a lot going on this slide, but for now, let's just pay attention to the bottom half of this, right? And this is the actual EPS-EBIT analysis here. Everything above this is the data needed to put this together. So you will need to spend some time getting data before you can put this EPS-EBIT analysis together, and probably the most time-consuming aspect of this is coming up with this first data point here, the amount of capital needed. So by this point, you should have IFEM, EFEM, swap matrix all put together, hopefully a QSPM as well. And based on those together, you should have come up with some set of recommendations. Each of those recommendations has some cost associated with it. The recommendations that you're actually going to be implementing should be added up, and whatever that summation is the number that you would use here for amount of capital needed, right? How much money does it take to implement the strategies that you're recommending? In this case, it's 100 million. And then we can open up like a Yahoo Finance or something similar and figure out most of these other numbers. So the rest of these don't take nearly as long to figure out. EBIT range, in this case, is 20 to 40 million. And this range represents kind of a worst case and best case scenario. So you can think of this in terms of how the economy is doing. Right, let's say the economy tanks, we go into a recession. In this case, the firm is estimating that 20 million is probably our earnings before interest and taxes, worst case scenario. Best case scenario, maybe it's a booming economy, we might be able to make as much as 40 million. And that's why you see in the first row down here, whether we're using debt, whether we're using stock, whether we're using a combination of the two, we're doing two different columns worth of math here. Because one represents how we're doing in a poor economy, one represents how we're doing in a great economy, or worst case scenario versus best case scenario, right? Same here for stock, worst case scenario, best case scenario. For the interest rate, you can just look at past years, use the same interest rate as they use for past years. Probably you can do that for tax rate as well. You may want to look and see, has the firm switched where their headquarters are, but generally tax rate remains pretty similar over time. So you can just use the financial statements to find that as well. If you go to Google Finance or Yahoo Finance, you can find the firm's stock price as well as how many shares are outstanding. So that's all the data that you need to put one of these together. But now let's go through and look at an example on how to actually conduct one of these analyses and come up with and earnings per share based on whether we're using debt, whether we're using stock, or a combination of the two. And so I'd recommend, as you put this together for your projects, you keep this handy here, and it'll make your lives a lot easier when you're actually going through to do some of the math. And if you click on the next slide, I've given you the math on how to do this as well. And then the remainder of this video, I'm gonna go into a hypothetical example and walk you through the process of doing the math to complete one of these EPS-EBIT analyses. So up here in the top left corner, we've got our data, right? So I would have hypothetically come up with a list of recommendations that I thought was appropriate for the firm. And the cost of those recommendations in this case is $3,724, which is obviously a low number. Maybe that's in thousands or millions or something. And then I've got an EBIT range. So 3,000 would represent a worst case scenario, perhaps a recession. The 3,800 would represent best case scenario, and perhaps a booming economy. And so this is where we're gonna start with this 3,000 and 3,800. And regardless of whether we're using debt, stock, or a 50-50 combo, we're gonna use this same range. So this row here is pretty easy, right? In a bad economy, we'd make 3,000, good economy, 3,800. And then we can just copy and paste that for these other two columns as well. There's two kind of tricky areas here where I see students sometimes go awry. One is interest, and the other is calculating number of shares. So pay particular interest in these two data points here as we go through this. Make sure you're able to do this. So we've got our earnings before interest and taxes. Next, we need to figure out how much are we paying in interest. And the easy place to start here is with 100% stock. Okay, if a firm is financing everything they need via stock, it means we're not going to a bank, and it means we don't have to pay interest. So this one is actually really simple, right? We can just enter zero for both of those, because if it's stock, there's no interest. Where there is interest is with debt. So we need to figure out, based on this amount of money, how much interest would we have to pay to get that much? And so now we need to do a little math. So we take the amount of capital needed and we multiply it by the interest rate. So to get $3,724, we're gonna have to pay interest of 112. And we can actually copy that formula and paste it in for the booming economy as well. Then lastly, here we have a 50-50 debt and stock combo. So there's a couple of different ways you could do this mathematically, but essentially we just need half of this number here, right? This is 100%, this is 50%, so we can take half of this interest and just stick it over here. Basically just divide that number by two. Oops. Okay, so next column, is earnings before taxes. And so this is just simple subtraction, right? 3,000 minus 112 in this case gives us our earnings before tax of $2,888. We use this same formula across all of them, so we can just drag that across, right? So here it's 3,800 minus 56 bucks. Next, we have to figure out taxes. So if this is our earnings before tax, how much tax do we have to pay on this amount? So again, relatively simplistic math. take the 2888, multiply it by the tax rate, in this case of 1%. I want to know where this company is because that is quite a low tax rate. Again, we can just use that formula across the board, but I need to lock in. So if you don't know much about Excel, you can use some dollar signs or press F4 and it will lock in that number. And then we can just copy that across. So there's our taxes. And then again, some simple subtraction here. 2888 minus the $29 gives us our earnings after tax. So now we get to the probably most missed area of this analysis, which is figuring out how many shares are needed in order to raise this amount of capital. And so this is kind of the opposite scenario that we saw up here with stock and interest. Okay, if we're using all 100% debt to finance our decisions, it means that we're not adding any more shares. Right, we're going to a bank instead, doesn't involve shares at all, but don't put zero here. Right, zero would mean the firm has no shares at all, when in reality it just means our shares outstanding doesn't change. So what you need to put here for debt is however many shares the firm already has outstanding, which in this case is 807. Moving on to the 100% stock column, remember here we're not starting with zero again, we're starting with 807. So we need to figure out how many shares do we need to add to this 807 in order to pay for $3,724 worth of recommendations. And the way we do that is divide in whatever the stock price is to that amount of capital needed. So you can do this right in the cell if you want to. I think it's sometimes easier just to do a separate step over to the side. So divide your stock price into your amount of capital needed, or 3,724 divided by 50 in this case, which gives us 74.48. So essentially we could reword this as, in order to raise $3,724 via stock, we need to issue 74.48 new shares. And so then the second step here is add this 74.48 to our number of shares currently outstanding, which is this 8. $807 plus the 74.48. And we could copy that to boom or recession. So 881 is the answer for both of those. And then for the 50-50 debt stock combo, essentially we're only using half stock. So the number of shares should be in between 807 and 881. Okay, and the way we find that is to basically break this number in half. So now we only need to raise half of this number, 3,724, with stock, right? Because the other 50% is going to be raised via debt. So another way to do that is just break this number in half. So rather than 74 shares, if we cut that in half, now we only need 37.24 shares, and we could then add that to the 807. The number of shares outstanding currently is 807. And if we raise half of this 3724 via stock, then we need 37.24 more shares. So that comes to 844, which is right in between 807 and 881, which means we probably did this correctly. Though I've seen it where it's not a 50-50. So it's not always quite so simple, right? It might be like 75-25, and then you have to do a little more math. Unfortunately, in this case, not so difficult. And so we're almost done now. The last step is to actually calculate earnings per share, right? And so We know how many shares given each scenario we have, and we know the earnings after tax. So now we just do some simple division, right? 28.59 in this case divided by 807 gives us an earnings per share of 354. And then we can drag that across. And we have our best case and worst case scenario for debt, best case, worst case scenario for stock, and our best case, worst case scenario for 50-50 debt stock combo. And as you would expect, the winner here is whatever earnings per share is the highest, right? We want to maximize our shareholder wealth. And so whichever one of these comes up as the highest EPS would be the one that you should be using for your recommendations, right? In other words, that's the one you should pick to finance your decisions. And so let's start by comparing our poor economies. I'll highlight those in orange. So in a poor economy, 100% debt is the winner, right? So we'll put a little X there. And then in a great economy, I'll highlight those in blue, the economy is doing very good, then 100% debt is still the winner here, which is nice because that makes it really easy to present to an audience, right? Regardless of how the company is doing, how the economy is doing in this case, 100% debt is always going to be the best. Let's say, for example, that the winner was 50-50 debt stock combo. In that case, you might want to put together a couple of other combos, like 25-75 versus 75-25, because there may be something better than 50-50. Although, you know, I've done a lot of these now, and I can tell you, most times, it'll fall under either 100% debt or 100% stock being the best. It's rarely a combo. So that is all I have to say on the subject for now. If you have any questions, certainly let me know. I'll also post this same exercise on As You Learn. So if you want to try to do it yourself, see if you come up with the same numbers, that would probably be in your best interest to do.